Leader. Marvin. It's a new thing on 106 Live Radio. The male perspective. Some may consider this the male therapy. Male empowerment. Or even male bonding. However, the male perspective is a place where we discuss genuine subject matters that men face on a daily basis. Welcome to the male perspective.
Great evening, great evening. Glad to have you all with us today on another beautiful, wonderful day, Wednesday. A day which we can celebrate and see and participate in life. Well, we're at the end of this day. But anyway, this is a great day today. We're going to have a wonderful show. Everybody is in the house, where everybody is present and accounted for today. So we're going to go ahead and get ready to rock and roll. Here we have, of course, my name is Willie LeGrand Jr. And we have
Ron Robinson.
And we also have...
This is Don E. Miller. What's up, man? How y'all doing?
What's up, Donald?
Oh, no, man. My name is Don, man. I know you try to do that purposely, man. I told you ain't no A.L. on my name.
That's great. So that means my name is not the only one going to be talked about then.
No, man. I'm gonna be like Birdman. Put some respect on my name, man.
Hey, bro. Oh, chill, y'all. Y'all better put some respect. You heard me?
Put respect on my name, man.
He did, didn't he?
What's happening with y'all, fellas? How y'all doing?
Hey, man. How's things going, man? How was everybody weekend, man?
It was great. It was great. Great weekend. Great holiday weekend. Great Thanksgiving. Time to be able to, you know, sit down together, be grateful, fellowship with family, have great dinner, you know, pig out, do all of the traditional stuff, but at the same time, put a little twist to a little spin, movie night, all that stuff.
Oh, you did all that, man? Movie night, all that? Wow.
All that on Thanksgiving, bro.
All that on Thanksgiving.
Get it all in and everything. You know, let's capitalize on it, you know?
Okay. All right. Willie, what's happening with you, man? What did you do, Willie?
Well, I went home to hang out with the family. My brothers came home. Of course, my sister did the majority of the cooking. All was well, man. I had a pretty good time. Dad seemed to be glad that all of us were there on the one roof and laughing, talking, having fun, watching the games, plural. Hey, man, one of the highlights of, in a negative way, we're watching the Alabama game, man, Alabama and Auburn. Fourth down and 30.
Wow.
Fourth down and 30.
Fourth down and 30. Boy, one of my brothers, man, that's all he could say, fourth down and 30. But anyway, all else was well, man, and, you know, life goes on, even though I had some people that I knew while I was there to leave, you know, and but I thank the Lord that we're still here.
Well, you know, that's the gratitude, man, of knowing where you are. But then even those people gone, you know, they left something in the earth, man, that we can all glean from. If you spent time with them, I'm sure they impacted your life in some kind of way. So I was dealing with some of that myself, a loss of a friend, and recognizing the impact that they had when they were here. So, you know, it's a new normal, but life goes on, as you stated. And so we have to continue to just give God the praise for allowing us another time to even get together as guys, and the time that we had with those individuals that have moved on, you know. So I'm just grateful for that. So I'm grateful for you guys also. You know, I think we've been doing this a little over a year now, man. And it's been a great ride, man. I mean, I think we've been gelling pretty well. And I think we've had people that's been listening and following us. And I'm sure it's just going to continue to grow. So even though we won together on Thanksgiving, I want to let you guys know, man, I'm grateful for the relationship that we've developed over this time frame, and hopefully we can continue moving forward as a group.
Okay, that sounds pretty good.
Amen, amen. Praise the Lord. Pass the collection plate. Yeah.
So you knew you was gonna have a preacher in the background talking about amen, praise the Lord. You know you was gonna have that.
Well, yeah, we gotta raise that offering.
You know he ain't gonna let us down. You know
he ain't
gonna let us down. So. Listen, so we're doing this piggyback off of week before last, you know, ramifications of childhood trauma, dealing with childhood trauma. And we had a, you know, it was really, really, it was impactful. It was great. And Don, we, you know, it's almost like as if you look at it, like we went in, which is good, because whether agreeing to disagree or whether we not on the same page, it was great because it pulled out of you what people were telling me was needed. Like a lot of times when you sit down with mental health therapists or psychologists, whatever, we don't get an in-depth of the approach. We don't get an in-depth of reservations of going here, but we are open to go here as long as individuals. And then allowing at the same time the bylaws of what the industry is and what they say we can or cannot, and the stipulations where a lot of people just think you're supposed to be. Just like, you know, just like with preachers, a lot of people just think as if, you know, God covenant with them is different from you because you don't preach or teach the gospel. It's not that. The cross makes the playing field level. So I'm glad we was able to have it to where, you know, some fire came out of you, fire came out of me, and both sides, both perspectives, both analogies, and both processes are so needed. And to me, it allowed me to say, okay, going forward, I think we can create something to where atmosphere is created for those in the mental health field, doctors of psychology, psychiatry, mental health specialists, all of those in the spiritual Christian field can merge together because both sides are so needed.
Well, it's true. And you find it may have been missing in the Black community more than anything else, but for years, you know, white churches and white institutions have always had some form of therapy in some of their congregations. You know, I've seen where right. they've had even AA meetings, NA meetings, they've had right. stuff that people call secular involving their church. And so I think when you look at counseling, it's so important that you look at both pieces. I think the spiritual piece is definitely needed, but I think also preachers have to be more skilled in understanding when do I take this off of me and give it to a professional to handle. It's almost like a doctor. You know, I need to give this over to a doctor to deal with. I need to get this right. over to, I've done so much on this end, so let me give this, let me refer them on to someone who's skilled in this particular area that may be able to help them better than I can. Because I believe the same way with me as a therapist. I can do a lot in my office and I can do a lot from the therapeutic standpoint, but there comes a time where I may have to hand them off and say, hey, you know, maybe you need to see a psychiatrist for medication management.
Right.
Maybe you need to see a physician to deal with some other health issues you may have. What's right. happening today is that people are merging those two together from health and mental health and physical health and all of that. But the spiritual piece is just as important. So all that is important, but it's not one is better than the others. How do you incorporate all those things when the time comes to incorporate all those things?
Right.
You know, and it's almost like we can usher a person into Christ if they really want that. But if they don't, the key is, and I said this to Willie the other day, is that you got to catch a fish before you skin the fish. If you're trying to skin the fish before you catch it, then you kind of going backwards when you should be trying to catch the fish. You got to get right. the fish first, you know. And so even with the spiritual side and all pieces of this, you first have to have a dialogue with the person. And as I stated earlier, not what's wrong with you, but what happened to you. And so Don, from that standpoint, it makes it much easier to find out some of those pieces.
So just to let you know, it's true. And I've seen this and I've been amongst it. I got, you know, white friends in the Christian arena, you know, as well as Black. Like I've listened to white pastors that never drank, never did drugs. And they say for years, they'll sit every week in an AA or whatever that their church has now incorporated, and they just sit and listen and be amongst the men. And they tell them, if you cuss, you cuss. Whatever you do, hey, it stays here. And they're sitting down because although they're the spiritual covering of this facility, this local assembly, they are like, I've never experienced what you guys have experienced. I don't know the pain of that. I can just sit here, pray, intercede, be available, but I want to listen because you guys are teaching me some stuff. And so I think, like you say, pastors, preachers, we have to be in the religious sector. We have to be open to understand that there are certain struggles that we individuals will have that we have no clue of the feeling of that, what it feels like, the mental torment of that struggle, and that we just have to sit and act as a loving person, availing themselves just to be a shoulder for you to stand, lean on, cry on, but at the same time to affirm you that God loves you, I love you, I'm here for you, I'm praying, interceding for you, and I'm with you through thick and thin. So through your struggle, without condemnation, all of that is so important, I think, to say this, we then bridged and came together in your world, in my world, and so for the betterment of humanity. That's plain and simple, because God created us all, and so therefore your gifts God put in you, my gifts God put in me, for the perfecting of the saints, for the edifying of the body of Christ. That's what I think needs to happen. And I think that by talking about it, we can now help bridge the gap, merge and cause the lanes to come together to where we merge together and everybody's going the same speed, going in the same direction.
Well, that's what you're finding now. You're finding churches now having a therapist on staff, not a mental health therapist on staff, because they know people are dealing with a lot of issues, whether it's marital issues, whether it's sexual identity issues, whether it's whatever. And by having a therapist, you're now saying, Pastor, instead of you trying to handle everything, we have a professional here on staff that will help. What happens is that's an important piece of the ministry, I believe, is to have, what are the needs of the people? How do we address those needs? And so when you was talking about that pastor sitting in that NA meeting, that AA meeting, what happens is that he's developing a level of competence now. Because now I'm understanding more about what's going on with you. So now by me understanding more about what's going on with you, I can get the things to help you. And I believe competence is one of the things that we have to start looking at, even when it comes down to culture. Certain people will look at black folks a certain way, white folks a certain way, and yet they don't have the competence of that culture. Even when you look at Hispanics. So when you're getting competence, then now you know what you're dealing with. You understand the people better. And I think that's one of the key pieces to this whole mental health piece and the whole spiritual piece, having a better understanding of what you're dealing with when you're talking about people struggling with anxiety, struggling with depression, struggling with post-traumatic stress disorder, struggling with all these things, you know, and it's like, what do we have that can meet the needs of the people? That's what we're looking at. What are the needs? Not what is, what is the actual need of my congregation, of a person coming in my church? Do they need parenting skills? Do they need to deal with depression? They've been through a divorce. They've been through some grief. Somebody died and they don't know how to handle it. Maybe we need to have some support, such as a therapist, to assist us with working with our congregation. And that's what that's all about. So I think the black community has to first embrace the need for having therapists on staff, therapists to help them understand and carry some of the load that the church has been trying to carry by themselves in the past.
Right. But see, at the same time, you have to be able to realize, like, for instance, I preach and teach all the time that if Satan is busy 24/7 and we have 8,700 plus hours in a year, but if you think about it, church is structured to where technically people only come together 2 hours a week. So you got 104 hours that people are, you know, getting spiritual fellowship or their spiritual needs met. And so we have to go beyond that to be able to sit back and say, okay, we probably need to have the doors of the church open. We probably need to have a transition phase. All of this stuff is needed, especially in days and times like this, November, December, January. So we know work is slow, kids out of school, holidays, it's winter, it's cold. This is the, you know, probably the 3 months of the year that the enemy comes in and through mentally attacks people with the pain of the past. We're talking about trauma and the ramifications of childhood trauma. So therefore, if a person is in a rural area, in an area where they've never been able to get the necessary help, what, like, okay, now we already know Satan is busy. We know that those thoughts, those pains, when you never deal with a wound, then everything that infects the wound continues to fester over and over and over. So we have to be able to know that there are wounds, there are things that people need to help with, and we have to ask ourselves, how are we getting better? And I say that to say, Don, there are a lot of, like, if you, majority of the conversation on social media, if we look at it, there's a huge percentage of mental health, but we rarely see it coming together as what we're speaking about, where we're bridging that gap, where we're coming together and we see effectively communities. Like, how about in 2024, we don't see 1 million mental health specialists in 30-minute clips, but we literally see a movement. We see a direction where we see the mental health, we've addressed it, we've recognized it. Now we're putting together teams to where, whether it's city to city or whatever, we're coming together and putting things to show how we're bridging the gap and we're joining community with the church and moving forward. Mental health specialists, psychologists, and everybody's coming with their perspective, their gifts that God has given. And now we see progress. We see healing. We see Black people and coming together and African Americans in the communities now speaking, willing to share their story, not necessarily worrying about or tearing down in the negative sense of shame of your past or condemning someone, but it happened. Now what do we do? What do we do about it?
You're right. You're right. And one of the things I hope that we can do in 2024 is, you know, doing some workshops in the community. I plan on doing some more stuff. It's not going to be about costs. It's going to be free. You know, I'm going to probably get with some politicians and some folks and try to use, you know, a library or whatever to just get the information out. Because I think a lot of times, man, people don't have the information, you know.
Right.
And again, we got to kill that stigma associated with mental health, because a lot of people are really living and dying in silence, man. And I'm saying living in silence because they're not talking about the issue, and dying in silence because they allowing that same issue to kill them. And it's almost like when you talk about abundance, you know, something is really keeping them, gripping them, and they're not letting it go. So they're in bondage. You know, and so the thing of it is, how do we free people up to be able to talk, to be able to share, to be able to keep moving forward versus staying stuck? And so when we talk about childhood trauma, when you see a lot of things that's happening with these adults, if you start doing a historical piece on them about their childhood, you will see that they've been exposed to some type of trauma, whether that's been an early divorce in their family, whether that's been a violence that they saw in their community or even in their home, a death, parents going to prison, all the things that you see today. Some of the things when it comes down to the sexual identity thing, kids are really struggling with that, man. I was talking to my nephew, and they were having a conversation. He's in the fourth grade. It's going to trip y'all out. They was having a conversation at the lunchroom table. And he said they was asking the question, was Jesus Christ transgender? Who has that conversation at 9 years old?
Right.
That means they've been exposed to something. They've been exposed to some type of event, some type of lifestyle that now they're beginning to look at that and say, wait a minute, was Jesus trans? asking questions about that, asking questions about sexuality, all of that. But that's because a lot of this exposure. And that could be traumatic for a kid, because now a kid's starting to wonder, well, is this right? Is this wrong? Do I live this way? Do I live that way? So any event can be very traumatic to kids. Those relationships could be. Think about it. See, we don't think about that. We think about ourselves. You see what I'm saying? We don't think about the impact it can have on a kid when he's young and as he get older. Right. See, right. So childhood trauma plays a major.
Right. So, Don, real quick, we got to go to break. We're at the 21 after. You're listening to 106liveradio.com, where excitement meets diversity 24/7. We are the Male Perspective. We'll be right back, talking about the ramifications of childhood trauma.
Broadcasting live from Atlanta, while serving the entire globe, it's the fastest growing radio on the web. It's 106liveradio.com.
Bullying, it not only affects the person who is being bullied, but it could also affect the person who is witnessing someone else be bullied. Please, let's remember to stop bullying on our school campuses and everywhere else. Join 106liveradio.com to help stop bullying.
A well-balanced lifestyle refers to a sustainable way of living that promotes your overall health and wellness. According to Drs. Jason and Tinashe Gray, authors of From Brokenness to Wholeness, Team Gray are international inspirational speakers and epic marriage advocates. Their prayer is that you pursue wholeness and harmony in every aspect of your life. You see, wellness involves creating a harmonious balance between your connection with God, life's calling, or vocation, family, relationships, leisure activities, and personal development growth goals. Some healthy self-care practices include regular physical exercise, a balanced diet, adequate sleep, and effective management of stress levels, all while cultivating meaningful relationships. You are a multifaceted human being. Therefore, we here at sourceofwellness.org encourage you to explore your innate passion and interests that bring lasting joy and deeper fulfillment. As you soar to a higher dimension, Team Gray's counsel to you is to optimize, begin the journey of becoming excellent in spirit, effective, and live based on your God-given gifts and mandate. It's time to function at your best and live up to your greatest potential.
Hi, this is Michael Lancaster. Hoping you'll join me every first and third Sunday on Life Talks with Gathering and Friends as we get into the Word of God and talk about its application to life.
I taught for 20 years until I started forgetting my lectures.
Eventually, he had to quit. Getting his early Alzheimer's diagnosis was hard, but it gave us time to take control of the situation together.
I can't imagine going through this without him.
If you or your family are noticing changes, it could be Alzheimer's. Talk about seeing a doctor together. For more information, visit alz.org/time-to-talk. A message from the Alzheimer's Association and the Ad Council.
Are you thinking of changing your marketing strategy? 106 Live Radio is the solution you need to promote your goods and services. We are offering special advertising rates on our fast-growing radio network. We can also help you create an audio commercial or a website banner that fits your business needs. It is just that simple. Visit our website at 106liveradio.com for details.
Bringing you the best shows and music 24/7 on your favorite radio. It's 106liveradio.com.
The Male Perspective is partially or in part sponsored by Contact Electrical Services, LLC, servicing all your residential and commercial electrical needs throughout the metro Atlanta area. And remember that without contact, you don't have power. Give us a call at 678-698-1101. Reach out to Contact Electrical Services today.
Join us on The Male Perspective Wednesday night, 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. on 106liveradio.com, where excitement meets diversity 24/7. we will have a weekly dialogue regarding various issues from a male perspective.
I searched the earth for something that could satisfy. A piece for the hurt I had buried deep inside.
Like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, and be sure to tell everyone else about 106liveradio.com.
All right, we are back. You listen to 106liveradio.com, where excitement meets diversity. We're talking today about the impact of childhood trauma in adults. The impact of childhood trauma in adults, and this is really panning out to be a really serious conversation. One of the things that was mentioned is about whenever someone deals with something as a child, it follows them later on in life unless they have gotten some help. And Don and Ron was talking about how now they're having therapists to come into the churches to be a part of the staff to be able to help them also. And one of the great things about that is that they have someone other than the pastor, because sometimes the lay member may not want to share that particular thing with the pastor. So then they have someone that they could trust, hopefully, and, you know, go ahead and share their feelings and their thoughts concerning, you know, whatever issues they're dealing with. And it's always great to be able to have someone that you can talk to, because if you talk about it, majority of the time, you will be able to deal with it and get rid of it. You'll be able to get rid of whatever issue that you're dealing with. So it's a great thing.
Yeah,
always to know that you have someone in your corner.
Right.
Someone has to be there for you. Oh, you remember this, 404-464-8785. That gets you into the conversation. So give us a call. I'm sure somebody has dealt with some trauma or know someone that has. Call us up and go live with us and share what you're thinking.
Yeah, so Don, piggybacking off of what we're talking about, and now here's the other thing you mentioned and we discussed. We have to also begin to talk about and push the issue of blacks coming out of their shell, coming out of the trauma is actually once we provide the atmosphere, once we provide an environment conducive for that presents, that is a safe environment. Now we need to discuss and talk about, like, okay, it's okay to talk about it and empower people to understand that whether you're the victim, whether you may have done something, partook in something that was traumatizing, that, okay, when you go before God, when you accept God and you accept his healing and his forgiveness, he forgives you. When we repent, God forgives. And by forgiving, he doesn't hold that against us. He doesn't use that against us. And he doesn't remember that according to his word. Too many times we have shame and we feel condemned. We beat ourselves down with feeling too condemned because not just what people think about me, but I know I'm shamed before God. And I think we have to be able to empower people to be able to know that God, once you repented, you took it to God, part of this healing process is you actually accepting forgiveness that God provides so that you can now begin the process of healing and moving on. Does that make sense, Don?
Makes a lot of sense, man. And what happens is that those two things keep people out of counseling. Sometimes condemned, being shamed, feeling guilty. And so they hide, man. But then you see the behavior.
Right.
That's one of the things about counseling is that you looking at behavior. When you start looking at mental health, you basically looking at behavior. And, you know, one of the impacts of trauma from childhood trauma as an adult is mental health. And reason why it's mental health, because from a childhood trauma, you dealing with emotional and mental scars, man.
Right.
Let's just take, for instance, if you were in a home where you couldn't open your mouth, that everything was, I say this and you don't say anything. And so what happens, a lot of times people go in relationships like that and they get in abusive relationship or they become the abuser sometimes. So one of those issues is mental health. So when people start having mental health, you start looking at, again, the data from their childhood, man. And so you're right. you need to be in a conducive atmosphere where you can be free to flow emotionally, flow verbally. You need to be able to. I've had clients that have come in and just was cussing, man. I just felt like cussing. Excuse me, no. I said, go ahead on. Do your thing. I'm all right. Do your thing. Get it out. Because I want you to get it out here in the office than taking it out on someone else out there in the street. You know, because it's important that you get a chance to vent and not be held accountable for being open about how you feel. It's okay for you to be mad. It's okay for you to be disappointed that you've been in a marriage that didn't work. It's okay you lost a job that you felt like the people didn't treat you right. But let's talk about it. Let's work through it. I remember one of my first counseling sessions for me was that I had lost the job, man. And I felt like the people did me wrong on the job, you know. And I went to a counselor and she was talking to me about it. And she said, well, maybe you didn't have this word savvy. I said, what do you mean savvy? And I looked up the word. She was talking about how I handled things. Right. And then she started talking about my childhood. Man, I broke down in the office crying. But I worked through that thing, man. I worked through it. And that was my experience of a counselor. So, you know, I'm a therapist, but I go to therapy, man. I believe some of our preachers need some therapy because they may have went through some childhood trauma that they never dealt with. So you may find ministers that go see counselors too now because they recognizing, hey, wait a minute. I'm dealing with all these people problems every day. I'm dealing with this. I'm dealing with that. Maybe I need to just sit and vent. I went to my counselor 1 week recently and said, man, I like your couch. He said, man, can I just lay on this couch for a minute? I said, I just need to lay on the couch, man, and let some stuff go. So it's so important, man, that we have create a environment that you're not being judged, but you're being helped. That's what it's all about, man.
And then at the same time, I empower people. Like, if we're going to sit down and we really discuss, like you say, you're going to vent, you're going to do whatever. But now you open and you ready for some solutions. Because after so much venting, after so much fussing and cussing, are we open to solutions? Or do you just want to literally come here to just say you want to fuss and cuss and vent and then go back into the same environment? Go back to so. We gotta now stop to really understand. Like me, I'm wondering where is after so long, even in my marriage, even in talking, I'm like, babe, you just like want to vent or you want some solution? Because, you know, like you didn't repeat it this 3-4 times.
It may take a couple of sessions for a person to begin to develop that rapport, that trust, because the main thing with most of us sometimes is just simple trust. I don't trust nobody. My trust has been broken before. So what make you so great that I'm going to come in and trust you?
Right.
You know, why should I trust you? And so staying with them over a period of time, hearing them vent, say, okay, all right. Now, what about that? Do you really want to change this? And sometimes people are like, I don't know how to change. I'm glad you asked that question. So now let's start moving towards something.
Right. So like for me, like personally, like, okay, if I speak from things that happened in childhood. So once again, as I tell everyone, grew up in a very religious, condemnatory, dictator type of ship environment. So it was always consequences. Like, so I sit back and it was like, okay, literally, like, so you, God, I didn't ask my mom before, like, so God, literally, you prayed and God told you to wake up at 2 a.m. and beat me because that glass was dirty. Like that's the revelation that you just come to that conclusion, right, mom? So she used to be like, as if, boy, I'm gonna fix you. I say, no, you're gonna leave me in the hands of the Lord. So in that dialogue, I'm sitting back. So for me, growing up, we meticulous, like it was straighten up, fly right, get it right the first time. Who cut that grass wrong? Who washed them dishes wrong? All this net. So for me, I had to make sure that I don't put this burden on my wife, on my son. So I just be like, he grew up, my son is 20 years old. He'd be like, my daddy never made me make my bed. He never made me wash dishes.
How many siblings do you have? How many of y'all was it?
It's four boys and one girl.
Four boys and
one girl. Yeah. Okay. Quit asking me all that, Willie. Oh, he's trying to. Willie, he want me to really cry.
We're getting into that trauma you done experienced, man.
So the thing about, but because here's the thing about it. If you grow up in a dictatorship, my wife and I, in the early stages of marriage, going to counseling is because we both come from controlling moms. So mm-hmm. we both was like, who are you talking to? Because we put a bitter root judgment of, I ain't putting up with, I vow to never. And so when we make that bitter root judgment, we become that very thing that we vowed not to. So that's the necessity. It has nothing to do with being a good person and a good heart. We subconsciously create environments that we're familiar with. And so when you come from controlling, stubbornness is there, all of these things here, and you got to really stop to think about it. I remember one time, one counselor, like Sabrina, had a problem with me, and I can operate in clutter. I don't need I ain't meticulous like that. I can operate in clutter. I'm good. Part of me don't want to do it because of the fact that we always got beat over consequences if we didn't have I's dotted, T's crossed. Who didn't make up this bed? Who didn't clean this bathroom, this and that? So with that being said, I'm a stickler. That's why sometimes I sit back. I remember one time I told Sabrina, you didn't clean up. She's like, I spent all day cleaned up. I say, you ain't pull that stove out. You ain't pull every dish out of that cabinet. And then I start saying, oh, wait, that's Joanne growing up. Because every Saturday, we literally had to pull every dish out of the cabinet, every pot and pan, and wash them. Clean every Saturday. Like clockwork. So when she sat back and made it, like, I'm talking about, like, literally they coming through with a white glove on. Like, I grew up in that type of environment. So I wanted to make sure that that's not, you know what? So one time a counselor says, if it has no bearing on eternity, leave it alone.
Wow.
So therefore, my cluttered desk, or you feel that I just left these clothes right here, she says, if it has no bearing on eternity, you have to embrace, leave it alone. And so that's the thing about going to counseling, because it's like it's trauma that I experienced, and I had to make sure that I say, okay, God, equip me and help me so that I raise my son and put him in environments conducive for his gifts that you put in him to be cultivated. It ain't about my life. It ain't about I want to see it the way I want to. And fathers and mothers have to understand that you have to really stop to think, are you literally going to make your child do it because that's the way you want to see it done? That's the way you want to see you do this equation. It's so many ways to skin a cat. It's so many ways to solve a math problem, but are we going to be stuck in, nope, it can only be this way, you know? And so I think that you have a lot of great people, Don and Willie, that went through in situations like that, that they're struggling with parenting because they're trying to do what's familiar.
You know, it's interesting that you said it because of the fact that that is what we are familiar with. We emulate what we've seen. And there's a commercial on television where this guy talking about, trying to keep people from being like their parents. But when you've seen something done over and over again, that's all that you know. But you did make an effort, or should I say, you made a statement to where you were talking about, were you going to be like Joanne, which is your mother, right. You said. Now, you did, and then you also mentioned the fact about something the way you said, when are we going to make that change? We hear this, we hear that, we get information, we get counseling. All right, but now when is the time for us to start implementing what we've learned? So what you've done, based upon listening to you, you said, you know what? I'm not going to be like I was brought up being. I'm going to turn this around. I'm going to be different. It doesn't always have to be every I dotted like I want it to be, or every T crossed like I think it should be. It's going to be done in a way that's going to be right. Our right always isn't what we think is right, just based upon the people that we're dealing with. Everybody's temperament and everybody is different. We have to find out, we've said this in previous shows, about we have to find out what is causing or what ticks for this particular individual. The counseling sessions, the therapy sessions, those are great because that allows the people to be able to hear, the counselor, the therapist, to be able to hear what the person has been going through, and then allow them, in most cases, the patient, to answer their own questions, because a lot of times people don't want you to tell them what to do. They want you to allow them to think for themselves, which in the majority of the time, it helps them. Because it's like, well, I don't want nobody telling me what to do, because when people begin to tell other people what to do, especially when they're grown, sometimes they get rebellious. Like, well, and then there are some that humble themselves and take their advice, because that's what they're there for, to get the help. And when that help comes across, then that's one of the greatest things that could happen. They begin to realize what they're dealing with, because trauma has happened in everybody's life. I had put something up there earlier on the screen about what trauma is. And there's something that I put up there. I thought about trauma, anything that accelerates the heart rate. And that's true. Whenever your heart, when something happens, no matter what it is or how serious or not serious it is, anything that brings about a change in your life, it changes the heart rate of a particular person. Fear comes in, doubt comes in, unbelief comes in. And then what they do is they start acting out on their feelings, because they don't know what to do. So therefore, now all this counseling, this trauma that has impacted the child, now has spilled over into the adult. So now where do we go from here? Because with this trauma, a lot of times as people get older, especially men, because they don't think, most men, I can't say all, most men think that they can handle it. They got it covered. But one of the most dangerous things that I've listened to today that has happened in 2022 was the highest rate of suicide in history, because of the fact that pressure was so severe that people did not know how to handle it, and they were not getting the help in which they needed. So they decided to end it all. And that's what happens when we're not listening to people, or people are not coming or feeling comfortable talking about the experiences that they had as a child, or even in some cases, a young adult or adult, then they don't see any way out but to end it all. And then what does that do? That brings trauma in the lives of the people that care about them. So we got to really put a real serious focus on this mental health thing.
And here's the thing about it. We have to be able to stop to, like, if I'm talking to parents of the baby boomer or the previous generation before baby boomers, grandparents, great grandparents, you have to realize that, like, every child is not gonna just, okay, they moved on, they gotten better. There are some that, because if behaviors doesn't change, meaning if parents don't show the children or the grandchildren that they're open for reconciliation, that they're open for change, then that's another stigma that people are struggling with, because of the fact that you have kids, grandkids that want to reconcile, they want to pour their heart out, but they're pointed out to a co-individual that did them wrong, that violated them. And apology, because my brothers and I have had this conversation with our parents. We've expressed some things, and then I tell my mama have expressed, well, I said I was sorry. I said, but none of your actions showed that you're sorry. None of your actions as adults. I say, and I'll say, that boy's struggling, mama. I say, you got to sit back and be able to stop. And you have to be, you know how Willie and Don, we come from a generation of daddies and grandfathers that I'm the daddy. Like, literally, my father and his brothers, here, you talking about trauma or whatever. One of my cousins, I told him we're going to be in Dallas last year. He live an hour and a half away in Oklahoma. Well, I'm the oldest. Y'all got to come see me. I said, you acting just like your daddy and my daddy. That's right. Because it was like, I'm the oldest. Y'all got to come see me. You got to call me. I'm the daddy. You got to call me. Literally. Like, I got uncles, my daddy, all of them, they be like that. So my daddy, my brother, he'd be like, well, I'm the daddy. Y'all got to call me. So I saw that with my cousin. And I'm saying, when you see things passed down, when you see familiarity and behavior patterns, that you're like, where did this stem from? So stubbornness, all of these things here. And if parents and grandparents are not open to sitting back and showing, and at the same time, creating that environment through the holidays or whatever, that son, daughter, you can express. And then from here, I'm going to show you by my actions that I want to do better. I want to actually walk in that love. I want to take the time and try to, I can't raise you again, but I want to show you, whether I'm showing up to my grandkids' games, whether I show up for their birthdays or whatever. How are you showing your kids that you're open to actually reconciling and allowing healing to really manifest.
Wow.
You know, the thing about that is a lot of times older people, the older generations, because they've seen that and done that so long in their lives, they don't see the need for change. And if they don't see a need for change, it's sad to say in most cases, they're not going to change. They will take that same attitude to the grave with them.
To the grave.
And then with that, there are so many other broken people that they left behind because of their stubbornness. And all they had to do was just show some concern, show that, you know what? I was wrong in the way that I treated you. I didn't have, I mean, please forgive me. Can you forgive me? Ain't nothing wrong with saying I'm sorry. Nothing wrong with being apologetic. It does not show weakness. It shows compassion, recognizing that maybe you were wrong in the way that you were handling different situations. And you can rectify that, because if not, the pain that, and the trauma that you've caused by being stubborn will trickle down unless the recipient is able to deal with it. It will trickle down, and then they will begin to do the same thing to the next generation.
Because that's what's familiar.
It's familiar.
And that's the pattern. And here's the thing about it. So for everyone listening, it's very vital and important that counseling is implemented just to be able to allow you to see how behavior patterns, you know, is. And once again, it has nothing to do with being a good person, having a good heart or anything, but certain behavior patterns. And we have to be careful to understand and know that, okay, this is what I was subjected to, but it doesn't mean that this is the environment I create for my children and bring them up in this type of environment. So now, it's cool. And then you got to gauge, okay, how do we do things? Where do we make adjustments? And seeing. So I just want to make sure that for everyone listening, that you have these type of dialogues with parents, with grandparents, for the purposes of reconciliation. You're listening to 106liveradio.com, where excitement meets diversity 24/7. We are the Male Perspective. We will be right back.
Their globe. It's the fastest growing radio on the web. It's 106liveradio.com.
Some people won't give you the real talk on drugs, but it's time we know the facts. Fentanyl is killing people. It's a powerful opioid, often made illegally and commonly mixed with illicit drugs. It can even be pressed into counterfeit pills that resemble prescription medications. Just 2 milligrams, about the size of a few grains of sand, can potentially be lethal. This isn't an ad to scare you, but it is an ad to make you think twice. Get the facts. Go to realdealonfentanyl.com. This message is brought to you by the Ad Council.
Irritable bowel syndrome, or IBS, is so common that it's likely you know at least one person with this functional disorder. Some IBS facts are 13 to 20% of individuals, approximately 5 to 7.5 million individuals are living with IBS. People of all ages have IBS, from young children to the elderly. The economic burden of IBS is $6.5 billion annually. Individuals with IBS miss on average 13 days of work per year, leading to a further $8 billion in lost productivity. The primary symptoms are what we call the ABCDs of IBS: abdominal pain, bloating, constipation, and diarrhea. Symptoms can come and go, so you might feel well for a while, only to get symptoms again. For more information, please visit badgut.org.
Self-monitor your blood pressure in 4 easy-to-remember steps. Self-monitoring is power. Visit managerbp.org. Brought to you by the Ad Council, the American Heart Association, and the American Medical Association, in partnership with the Office of Minority Health and Health Resources and Services Administration.
The Male Perspective is partially or in part sponsored by Contact Electrical Services, LLC, servicing all your residential and commercial electrical needs throughout the Metro Atlanta area. And remember that without contact, you don't have power. Give us a call at 678-698-1101. Reach out to Contact Electrical Services today.
Three powerful words with the same letters, now own. and one could change your daily life, business, or ministry. Will you go for it and win three in a row? Tic-Tac-Toe of Life, the Now, Own, and One Anointing is an inspiring new book by evangelist Dr. Curtis Minter that can help you understand the vision, passion, faith, and attitude necessary to fulfill your destiny that God purposed you to have. Available at Amazon, your local bookstore, or at Trilogy.tv.
Do you need a written game plan for your marriage? Here, you will be empowered to shed some of the heavy weight from the past. These practical tools can be implemented today. Start pursuing intimacy, effective communication, and be the interdependent mate you were designed to be. Are you ready to be vulnerable and transparent with your spouse? You will be challenged to take your relationship into the next dimension of perpetual growth. Check out Mr. and Mrs. Epic Journal, After I Say I Do, by Drs. Jason and Tanasha Gray.
We are broadcasting live from Atlanta Studio, 106 Live Radio.
All right, we are back, 106liveradio.com, where excitement meets diversity. We're talking about the impact of childhood trauma in adults. Don, we got a question here. I'm going to put it up here on the screen. Somebody want to discuss this. Is trauma playing a role in causing youngsters to pick up a gun and kill someone?
Yes. And they're saying, discuss, please. Yes, it does, because it's either two things happen. When you're exposed to violence, you either become violent or you're not violent. So if a kid has been thinking that, hey, I'm not going to live to be 25. I'm not going to live to be 30. So I need to handle things while I'm alive. So if they've seen violence, it's much easier to pick up violence versus try to get away from violence. A lot of us get caught up in this thing called respect. You didn't respect me, so therefore, I got to get respect. So carrying a gun is a form of respect, a form of keeping you off of me. I'm not going to walk away. See, walking away seems like you're weak, so I got to show some strength. So having a gun and not allowing somebody to take advantage of me or look like I'm being taken advantage of, I got to use this gun. If you beat me, we get in a fight, and you beat me in the fight, I'm embarrassed. So now I got to take you out. Instead of taking the fight, you lost. Okay, we lost the fight. Let's go on. Let's keep moving. No. Today, kids are saying, I need respect. So a gun plays the role as respect. And so sometimes kids pick up guns because they want to be respected. Some of them are being bullied. So I'm always looking at how could you stop from getting involved in a confrontation to avoid a confrontation then versus engaging in a confrontation. And so for some people, they'll say, well, you scared. No, it's not I'm scared. I just got sense enough. I need to be around to talk about it. Because right. If not, you know, I may end up losing my life. So if you want to call me scared, call me what you want to call me, but I want to live. And so that means I'm trying to avoid a confrontation.
So here's the other thing. Another thing that plays a part in that is back to what's familiar. So if you grew up, whether it's the ratchetness, the hood, but music, the influence of music in what they continually hear, you hearing gangster rap, you hearing people saying, talking about the hood life and smoking folks and all this and that. There's a big old huge, you know, not debate, but there's a big old like thing going on in the hip hop world or whatever, because there's a gospel artist rapper that's confronting, calling out the lyrics in rap music and stuff. And so to the point to where, you know, some of the rappers have chosen to actually make it as if I see him, it's going to be confrontational or whatever. But he's actually looking at how you're promoting violence in your music. But you say you love the hood. You passing out turkeys, but steady promoting violence, abuse of women, all of this in your music. And is a big thing going on now on social media. So we got to really think about it. And I say that to say, here's the thing, Willie. When my son came home this week for Thanksgiving, he was sitting back and he said that, like, in the locker room one day in the weight room, everybody was amazed because, you know, they started playing gospel songs. And they were like, Trey, how you know all them songs or whatever? You know, old school gospel, they was coming this and that. He say, man, that's my daddy would blast that every day. Like, that's like, I would be woke up to that music. So he remembered the Kirk Franklin and the family, old songs, all of this, the melody. They was like, man, you really know those songs there. So I say that to say the environment, Willie, of what's being infiltrated, because you got to realize this. If to be carnally minded is death, to be spiritually minded is life and peace. So what's influencing us? Is this music stirring up my carnal nature, which now anger, bitterness, resentment, all of this stuff here? And if that's the environment that I'm subjected to, if that's what's on social media, then I'm going to revert back to that. I'm going to do what's familiar in the hood. And like Don say, you disrespect me? Think about this, Willie, before you say something. If it's almost like this. You can talk to a kid that's a great kid that ain't got no, never had no smoke or nothing. And you'll say, hey, I'm going to buy you a gun for your birthday. Oh, that's what's up. I got that Glock now. And it's almost like you ain't never had a gun and been in the environment with a gun. But they'll get rowdy because that's the end thing.
Right. You know, you were talking about the young man and rap. We got a major case here where this young man is on trial now for causing people to be shot, killed. And he's the producer, supposedly, or founder of this gang here in Atlanta. And so his music, once you listen to his music, it promotes that kind of thing. It promotes that kind of life. And it's saying that he had to play hard and he had to be hard because he was one of 11 children. I don't think that the number or amount of people in your family dictates what kind of person you become. Your decisions in your life, well, it can have an influence, but what you wind up doing later on when you find out what kind of impact it has on other people's life, I think you want to change. If it's producing life and positivity in the neighborhood, then so be it. But if it's causing people to lose their lives and kids to lose their life while you're promoting something and getting paid, I think your thoughts are wrong. The morals are wrong.
Right. It's about money, man. It's about money. It's about, I keep telling you, man, there's a difference when whatever mission you have is your mission is about developing people and being great for people to be great. Or is your mission is about, let's get some money. And so if your mission is about based on money and how you're going to go about getting the money in a negative way, that's what you're going to do. And all that is glamorized, man. It's glamorized. Some of those rappers ain't as hard as they putting out that they are. Some of those rappers came out of suburbia, but they know what people like. So I'll give you what you like, but I won't give you the truth of who I really am. Right. And so it's important that our young people are monitoring what they listen to. I guarantee you a lot of these young people, parents, don't monitor what they listen to. They just allow them to listen to it. There was a time when we grew up, y'all know this, that on Sunday morning, every radio station would have gospel on to at least 12 o'clock.
Put the spirituals on.
Put the spirituals on. You would hear the spirituals. And exactly. So you may listen to some R&B later that afternoon, but that morning, you weren't listening to no R&B. Right. And so my point is that, now, I ain't saying anything wrong with R&B, but we got to get back to some basic values, man. I was talking to my nephew the other day. I said, man, I need to monitor what you're watching. He said, well, man, I'm watching this show. I said, no, man, you can't watch that. You 9, but you're watching the show for 14-year-olds. No, man, we can't do that. Because you need to be 9 as long as you're 9. When it's time for you to be 14, you'll be 14. What's happening with a lot of our young people, they've been exposed to things they're not ready for, man.
Right.
And our parents are just letting it go down because it's social media. You know, they need a telephone. You know, what a 6 to 7-year-old kid need a telephone for?
But that's part of the trauma that they operate in, that, and they're expressing pain of that trauma.
Yeah, and see that trauma. See, that childhood trauma now has impacted your decisions as an adult. Let me give y'all seven of the impacts.
Hey, Don, you might have to hold over because we're getting ready. We're at the top of the break. Top of
all
the
right. Hour. Appreciate it. Appreciate it.
Hold on.
...106 R&B and throwbacks on 106 Live Radio. Radio. Atlanta's music leader.
It's a new thing on 106 Live Radio. The male perspective. Some may consider this the male therapy. Male empowerment. Or even male bonding. However, the male perspective is a place where we discuss genuine subject matters that men face on a daily basis. Welcome to the male perspective.
All right, it's yours.
All right. I want to give our audience seven ways childhood trauma impacts people as adults. I told you one earlier, which was mental health issues, substance use disorders, dual diagnosis disorders, poor sense of self-worth, flashbacks, heightened responses to stress, and a loss of self. Check that out, man. I don't want to go in depth. I wish I could, because I know I'm going to be cutting loose from you guys shortly. But those are the seven ways childhood trauma impacts people as adults. And a lot of our decisions as adults, and we may not believe it, but it comes from our childhood. We can sit in what we do and what we don't do is going to be based on how we were developed. I have a brother, and he told me this, man. He may be listening. He said, my mama was so hard on them being clean. Said right now today, he can't leave his house without his bed being made up.
Right. See?
God, man.
I don't. I can't do it either. I can't do it.
And so it's important. You know, I see what the one of the listeners said. It's hard to keep your children from the violence today because of the music and social media. How do we protect them? You got to monitor them. You got to monitor what they do. No, yeah, we all were sneaking, doing some stuff behind our parents' back. I'm sure every one of us did. But a lot of stuff that as a parent that's been invested in you, you will remember. And so I think parents have to still be parents. It's still your job, as long as your children are in your house, to monitor them, to help develop them, to grow, to be the best that they can be. If that means you don't listen to this kind of music, you're in this house. That means right. You don't be on the computer this period of time, you're in this house. Now, when you get grown, you do your own thing. But in my house, you know that old saying, in my house, we going to serve the Lord.
Right, right.
So that means you got to have some boundaries. You got to have some values in your home. You still the parent. That kid is relying on you.
Right.
Not you relying on him. He's relying on you. Him or her is relying on you right now. So be the parent.
Right. And part of dealing with the trauma is accepting what their understanding and knowing what their environment is and what they actually subjected to when they're not around you, school, the school bus, the playground, all of this area here. But what are you doing to counter that by once again, sowing into their lives, planting that seed, instilling in them things to let them know, hey, God got a purpose for you. God protect you. I pray for you every day. I speak over your life. All of these things here, whereas now death to self is saying, God, thank you for using me to bring this child to the earth, but mm-hmm. You created this son, you created this daughter, and now let your purposes, your plans, your provisions direct their steps. When they're trying to go left, go right. Your faith, if we're applying faith, you have to have faith to believe that God is aware of this, of what they are subjected to. They go off to school, when they're on the school bus, everything. And that now, God, they are not with me physically present I'm in their presence, but you, my faith says you're going to protect them. You're going to care for them. You're going to watch over them. And you, and by reaffirming and letting the child know, every time they hear you praying for them, all of that stuff. You're planting seeds that allows them to where that struggle on the inside, they can understand and know that, okay, my dad is cool. My mom is cool. They really sit back. And being able to be open to sitting back and saying, let's really talk about that. Okay, so this is what your friend's parents said to him. Okay, tell me what you think about that statement. How do you feel about that? And so let's discuss it. Let's have a dialogue. Let's create atmosphere that's conducive for he or she to be able to feel they can express and then get clarity on certain things when they're confused.
Good stuff, man. Good stuff. Well, hey, fellas, I'm going to have to cut loose from y'all tonight. Man, it's been a great dialogue. I know Ron and Willie, y'all going to continue this dialogue. And like I said before, it's important that we parent. And don't be scared to parent. Be you. Be transparent about the mistakes you made as a child. In order to get in touch with me, you can all go to theeeffect.net. That's theeeffect.net. Or to reach me, you can go to dmiller@theeeffect.net. You can also go to my IG account, Don_E_Miller. That's Don_E_Miller. We will be, you know, I want to give the announcement. I talked Willie and Ron and myself. We'll be off the air for the next month because we're just taking a little vacation. The station is, and we'll be back in January with some exciting shows. But in the meantime, feel free to check us out. Some older shows at 106liveradio.com on YouTube, Facebook. So check us out still. We're looking forward to a great 2024. We got some exciting stuff. I was sitting here looking at some of the shows. Is it really your baby or maybe? We're going to be talking about parental a fraud, man, you know, paternity fraud. We're going to talk about his and her story, Black history. We got a lot of stuff in store for you all in 2024. So, guys, as I leave, I appreciate you. I'm sure we're going to connect this next month sometime. So you all take care. This year has been a great year for us, and we're going to continue to move forward next year. See you guys later, man.
All right, Don. Be safe, bro. Take care. Yeah, so in continuing, Willie, with, like you say, dealing with childhood trauma, that's another phase of trauma. Insecurities, feeling like low self-esteem, that we now, because of something happened to us, we're not confident as a mother, as a father. We're struggling in those areas to say, I want to raise my, I'm too afraid to go against the grain. I'm too afraid to stand firm on what I believe. I'm too afraid to stand firm. If you really think about it, Willie, like we through the autobiography and through the movies of Malcolm X, we kind of stem in what we read about Malcolm X or whatever. But if you really think about it, let's look at the depiction that was given of his daddy. I'm a man. I stand firm on what you believe, whatever this and that. Even through his conversion or whatever, and all of the things that were going on back in those 40s and 50s and 60s, when we look at Malcolm's boldness and what once he embraced what he believed in, once he embraced that, you know, this is the way he's choosing to believe, we have to stop to look at the boldness that he operated in, because he always reflected in that movie on the boldness of his father. Even to death, like when we see him laying on that train track, whether that's the actual way that he died or whatever, he's screaming, I'm a man, as if to my son, you stand firm on what you believe. You stand firm on what's right. You don't bite your tongue for nobody. What you believe in, regardless of the ramifications or whatever. And I just say that to say, we got a lot of people that are struggling, that are so insecure, that they're afraid to go against the grain of what their children are partaking in. They're afraid to sit back and say, "Not once you cross this front door, you cut that mess off. That attitude, and I say that to say because unfortunately you got a lot of mothers raising boys, trying to do their best they can to hopefully try to tame the beast of the man that's inside. And they're afraid to go against the grain. Like, envision the percentage of male and female that has the temperament of Adrian Balboa, Rocky's wife. You got a lot of people like that. Too afraid to say certain, just, I'm just trying to exist. If I got to go to work, I got a temperament for 8 hours. And so hopefully, but as kids mature, as kids grow, I see a lot of parents, a lot of mothers that deal with sons that they don't know where this behavior come from because they never was part of that child's dad's life. So they don't know that child's paternal side of the family and behavior attributes. All of these things here that father was killed in the drive-by. And so now all of those behavior attributes, you got a son that you have all of that. And next thing you know, young men struggle with. We struggle, even adopted young men, they struggle with once they find out that they are adopted, they struggling with who my daddy is. I want to know who I come from. All of this stuff here. And so now mentally they carry that over into, and it's a struggle, it's a weight that we don't want to deal with. Or people, you try to say, I'm a man up. I'm a woman up. I'm going to try to get this here going. I'm going to try to be better. But the weights and the pressures of life, and next thing you know, their children are now changing. Their children in the atmosphere. You got parents that are afraid, really, because just like Don mentioned, with everything that the kids are facing, parents worried, like, do I send my son to a public school based on what they believe in? Based on what they're teaching. Think about this. Parents that come from morally sound backgrounds that are now facing, and that child is now, they got to have discussions and conversations. And, you know, you grow up already. Don't tell everybody your business. So you struggling as a man, as a woman, my child struggling with sexual identity, all of this stuff. How do we have these dialogues? All of this is part of childhood trauma that we got to be able to create atmospheres, as we were speaking of, to be able to deal with this stuff.
You know, the thing concerning the young men that their dads might not have grew up in the house with their dad or their father. I think that the reasoning behind their behavior, the young man's behavior, or even the young woman's behavior, young girl, the young man is, like you said, maybe trying to find identity. And what usually happens, especially now they have so much social media going on out there that they expose to so much, to where this is what they pick up. They say, okay, well, this seems to be the way to get certain things done. This seems to be the certain way you talk to certain people. And then this is the reaction, not realizing that a lot of this stuff is staged. And when you're watching television and movies, you're looking at the results that they're getting, but then you're not really experiencing the real ramifications of the consequences for their behavior. Mama used to say all the time, everything that glitter ain't gold. I'm sure everybody has heard that phrase before. Everything that glitter isn't gold. And what you see being depicted on television is a lot of times fictitious. So what has to be done is that in the young man's life, what the mother can do is put, you know, an uncle that could be trusted, or a grandparent, or their parent, or somebody that, a church deacon or a pastor, somebody that they feel that they could trust to talk to this young man, to mentor this young man. There are a lot of mentoring programs now that for young men that are out here to trying to give them a positive image. And one of the largest organizations that we have here in Atlanta is 100 Black Men.
Right.
And that organization right there is positive, and they do a lot of things in the communities. Registration isn't that hard. The only thing you have to do is connect with somebody, and they have meetings. They used to have meetings once a week on Saturdays. And they would come together and share information and talk to the young man about personal hygiene, grooming, respect, and all the other stuff that usually is taught by their parents. However, that is no excuse for the young man's behavior to be off the hook, you know, to be off the chain. Respect is what's being needed and what should be given from that particular young man or particular child.
Willie.
We can't. Yeah.
Willie. Let's talk about that. Let me throw a situation.
All right, go ahead.
Okay. I'm your son.
Okay.
You come into my life and I'm 15. For whatever reason, you choose to come back now and be part of my life.
All right.
I go, mama say, you know what? Give you a chance. Go stay with your daddy, whatever this and that. Am I just supposed to automatically respect you?
Well, it's interesting that you say that. I know this young man, he knew his dad. His dad is a little older than, age ain't really got nothing to do with it. To answer your question, at 15 years old, this man comes into your life now. The first thing that you have to do is to be willing to open up. Of course, he hadn't been there for the first 15 years of your life. You know of him, but you don't know him. The thing what I think should be done, this is just Willie talking, is afford the opportunity to find out where he's coming from. Get to know him so you know what you're going to be like or what you don't want to be like. But if you're coming in with an attitude, it's going to be a waste of time because you're going to be rebellious from the jump street once he starts saying things to you, especially if he's trying to tell you what to do. You're going to buck up and say, well, you ain't been in my life all these years. Now, what gives you the right to say this to me or tell me what to do? Well, it's not the fact that it gives him the right. The right is that you need to listen to see what he's talking about. Give him the opportunity to be able to converse with you. If you've already built a wall, time can be wasted.
Now,
and then you're wondering, why am I acting like this? Well, because you decided you didn't want to listen.
But now, Willie,
yeah,
you gotta take you yourself as the father. You gotta sit back and say, it's some blows I'm gonna have to take.
Oh, absolutely.
And so, and from there, I now as the father have to say, am I at a mental place or am I getting the necessary counseling and everything so that I can be poured into, so that I can deal properly with my angry, mad, bitter, hurt son that has watched his mama struggle, that has seen my negligence. See, I say that to say, because I remember one time I had this conversation with some men, and I say, hey, bro, you got it. Like, so he going to live with you for the first time, and he's 16? Nah, bro, you gonna have to yourself go get some counseling, because this here beating on your chest and trying to make it like you the male dominant and ain't no way in the world I'm going to deal with being disrespected. You disrespected this dude for 16 years by never trying to be part of his life. You completely disrespected him and told him, basically, you treated him like you stumped him, you poured him out, he was in a good drink that you poured out, you stumped all of his, that's the way he's feeling. And you're going to sit now in the man that you feel, that's if you really think about it, Willie, there are a lot of men, a lot of fathers that struggle because their pride is, I will never let nobody, or my daddy raised me to have respect. My daddy raised me to be X, Y, and Z. And so you got to stop to say, bruh, how you willing to humble yourself? And literally embrace the process of you being able to now walk in love because you've never walked in love toward this child for 16 years. And you have to know that you never did. So we got a caller. Hey, caller, how you doing? Hey, caller, how you doing?
I'm doing great. How you doing today?
I'm good. What you got?
I'm just listening to what Ron is saying right now. And one thing I just kind of, it just keeps nagging at me, and that is that, you know, first of all, that father, it's very important that he find out the relationship and the communication that the child and the mother have had, because it could be a situation where the mother did not allow that child to be a part of that father life. And a lot of men today, they don't know their rights. They don't know how to go out there and get the right to have that visitation to do this and that, especially they do not have any guidance. So, you know, if a mother just take a child and relocate that child and then speak negative about that father when that father is trying to be a part of that child life, how would you deal with a situation like that? And how would that father and then that mother decide, okay, I want this child to go stay with his father now because I can't handle him. But at one point, the mother has poisoned the child mind against the father, and then how that father will repair that situation. And you said counseling, and I think that's going to be a very important part of it. But, you know, I'm just sitting here wondering, how do you get past that?
So it's several different ways you can approach it. And just be mindful that we're going to be taking a commercial break in about a few seconds. So we'll continue after commercial break. But I will expound on a couple of points. In all thy getting, get understanding. We know that's what Solomon advises us in the book of Proverbs. So in all thy getting, get an understanding. It is very important, first of all, for the father to gain understanding, to know the situation. As a man has to sit back and know that if that's a son that's being neglected of a father, then we know he has to be aware as a man the things that that child will be dealing with. As a man, he has to be able to, first of all, know that the negative influences, if the relationship was bitter, broken, rocky between him and the mother, then therefore he has to recognize that it's potential that seeds of discord have been sown into my son. So I have to now make sure as a man that I can go, I get the necessary counseling, I do whatever it takes for me to be willing to take all of the blows that come with trying to reconcile this relationship. And there's going to be torn brokenness. There's going to be anger, bitterness, all of those things there. I have to sit back and make sure that I'm in the mental capacity, that I have the mental capacity to be able to go forth and do that. You're listening to 106liveradio.com, where excitement meets diversity 24/7. Carla, if you hold on while we take a quick commercial break, we'll be right back so we can further continue this dialogue.
Also, talking about what's on your mind, call in at 404-464-8785. The Male Perspective, broadcasting on Wednesdays from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. on 106liveradio.com, where excitement meets diversity 24/7. And now, here is your host, Don Miller, co-host Willie Grand Jr., with Ron Robinson, 106liveradio.com.
We're back, we're back, we're back. You're listening to 106liveradio.com, where excitement meets diversity 24/7. We have a call on the line. And Carla, are you still there?
I am.
Okay, so you have to, the man, I recommend, and the man has to accept and be responsible enough and be willing to sit back and say, okay, there's going to be, if I'm going to reconcile, if I'm going to help my son get on the right path, if I'm going to help bridge the gap, and accept my negligence as well. Accept that, and what I mean by going to counseling, it's not just necessarily to deal with the trauma that the man experienced or that the man may have caused with the mother and the son, but it's also going to counseling to understand, okay, how am I wired? What am I willing to put up with? What am I not? Did I come from an old school dad? What, am I ex-military? Is my father ex-military? Where I have to realize if I feel there's certain levels of disrespect that you're not going to come in with me and you better never, ever say nothing negative or talk to me, it's going to be hard to bridge that gap. It's going to be hard to reconcile that. So that's why it's necessary, especially when you're dealing with already you, even though the mother played the son against the father and chose not to, here's the thing, as time goes along, because of this, the environment that we're in and the world we live in, if the father neglects to actually pursue his rights, if the father doesn't show that he's willing to take it to court, he's willing to fine, hire a private investigator, whatever, if you're not willing as a man to take those steps, then you're just saying you don't want to deal with it. And when you don't want to deal with termites festering in the house, when you don't want to deal with the roof caving in and leaking, then sooner or later the house gonna be destroyed. Does that make sense?
It make a lot of sense. It definitely make a lot of sense.
Oh, one thing too, Carla, that you did mention. One thing too that needs, Ron was touching on it too. The fact of the matter that the woman had played the dad against the son, or failed to allow the child to see his dad whenever he was thinking that he wasn't caring about him. I think what needs to happen is that, and then the child finds out later on, say this child is 16, 17, 18 years old, or maybe even younger. They seem to mature a lot faster than we did when we were growing up. But however, what needs to happen is that that mother needs to sit down with that child and tell the child the truth, that they may have been hurt because of the situation that didn't maybe pan out, but yet and still that they shouldn't have acted the way that they did by keeping this child away. And then in that, if the dad has a relationship or can obtain a relationship with the mother as far as communicating with about the son, then I think all three of them need to sit down and talk. Now, if he's willing to do that, that will be a great step. If she's willing to do that, that will be an even better step because she's the one that has initially caused the trauma based upon the example that you were given. When that happens, then I think some forgiveness can occur. A relationship can begin, but the child must be open to understand because he's definitely going to be angry at the mother. No doubt about it. He's definitely going to be angry and rightfully so. That doesn't mean he don't love her. He just hated the fact or disliked the fact that he treated him that way by keeping his dad away when all the young men, all children, boys and girls, they desire a relationship with their father because that's one of the most important people that will ever be in their lives. Not discounting the mother, but the father is one of the most important people that will be in their life. So they need that. And if they can get that, then I think that some healing can occur. And if you have to, go to a counseling session together, all three of you, and get rid of the anger that the mother has. The child can begin to deal with the anger and frustration that he has with the mother and the dad because he's in the middle and he doesn't know any better or he didn't know any better. So this is what needs to happen. They need to be a serious discussion going on. We hope we address your questions. Anything else you're concerned about or want to ask?
Well, I'm definitely excited about your topics for next year, talking about the fraternity, getting more information about male rights, because our young men need to know their rights. So I think that would be a very good hot topic for the young men.
Oh, great. Okay. Well, thank you for tuning in. We appreciate your call. Call a friend, tell a neighbor, 106liveradio.com, where excitement meets diversity, and the male perspective is on.
Thank you so much, Carl.
I appreciate you. Yeah, Willie. That's a very great question. And like you say, but here's the thing it goes back to what we were speaking of before the caller called. As men, when that relationship is broken, you have to ask yourself as men, and for fellas that's listening online, on Facebook, on Instagram, what do you think needs to take place? A father has neglected his son, hasn't been in the son's life, and all of a sudden at 15, 16 years old, the father is now finding himself, continually picking up, raising a child, trying to bring in discipline, trying to bring in love. What has to take place? Because I think, once again, Willie, if we are you got a strong-minded, you ain't going to talk to me crazy, you ain't going to disrespect me, you ain't going to raise your voice in my house, father, then I think that's going to be too much friction because you've never been here for this child. This child is not accustomed to your authority. This child is not used to having to submit to a male authority figure. So I think we have to be careful in doing that because now, of course, at the same time, since we're talking about dealing with and the ramifications of childhood trauma, we have to be mindful of the trauma that we as fathers may be experiencing from what happened to us. And here's the thing that we have to be careful of. Just because it happened to us doesn't mean it's okay for our children to experience that. Just because it happened to us does not mean it's okay for our sons and daughters to have to experience that and to have to deal with the ramifications of whatever is our healing process or our venting process or whatever, because of the pain that we harbor in our hearts. And so we have to be careful and mindful that the childhood trauma that we experience we don't deflect that onto our sons and daughters. It's very important, because other than that, that's where, here's the thing about it. People sit back, Willie, and you'll hear all of the time, you know, that's them generational curses. And, you know, that's the generation, that's them Robinsons, that's them Johnsons, that's them Smiths, all this stuff, this and that. So let me put it out there so everyone can know. On the cross, Christ broke the generational curses. He gave us the freedom and liberty to now walk in the newness of life and power and reconciliation and a renewed mind spiritually. But it is our job to change the familiar course of action. So it is our job to renew our mind so that way I am not going to be like what I see in my earthly bloodline. And I'm going to actually renew my mind, because the blood of Christ gives me that power to renew my mind. And with that being said, too many times we choose to just cop out. We choose to blame what is familiar in the bloodline as if it's a generational curse. When you accept Christ in your life, you are not cursed. Now, the enemy will try to use what's familiar, because Satan can only attack you with what's familiar in your earthly bloodline. He will try to use that to attack you and make you think you under a curse. But you have to renew your mind to know, I am not under a curse. The power that God gives me through Jesus Christ allows me to walk in freedom and liberty. So now, God, give me strength to make sound decisions. Give me strength to now renew my mind so that I'm not overtaken by what is familiar in my bloodline. Others may choose not to walk in that, but you have to be able to know, because therefore it will now either enhance or it will hinder your walk and how you raise your kids. What's familiar? And we have so many dialogues and conversations. And I just say that to say, here's the thing, Willie, you've been around me, and you know I'm going to consistently say right what's right. I'm going to consistently do it this way or understand. So in spite of my son, and whether you listen to whatever you listen to, he goes to HBCU now or whatever this and that, I found out through the experience of growing up and raising a son, that children look at consistency. They look at how is my father going to be consistent? Where's my mother going to be consistent? And as men, we have to be consistent in what our sons see. We have to be consistent in what we project to them. You're a man. God created you. I'm your father. I'm proud of you. God chose me to raise you. Here's the thing. It's a fact. You can't live with me. You're not in my retirement plan. So you got to learn it, live it, love it. And the consistency of that, when they can, look, watch this. But at the same time, on the flip side, you sit back and they see, you know, man, my dad a fool, man. That boy, that crazy. Whatever. They see that you can sit back and have that dialogue. They see that you can say, hey, bro, let me holler at you real quick. So you think that's the right way to go? Understand. Always tell me the truth. Now, then you give them that come to Jesus moment. Do you believe I will break you in half? I just want to know, do you really believe that? I want to know what you believe. You know, Jesus asked the disciples what they believe about him. As my son, I want to know what you believe. You believe I'll throw you through a wall? Okay.
Now you're injecting trauma.
No, no. So here's the thing. So once you actually say you believe that, now, don't ever cross this line. Because if you feel, see, you got to give them real life scenarios. You got to give them situations. Like, for instance, do I piss you off when I just bust in your room? When I come in there and act like I'm Debo, do that piss you off? Heck yeah. See, it's cool to say that. Okay. When you do this, I'm ready to choke the life out of you. See, and being able to create that atmosphere, because here's the thing about it. They already know you love them, because children spell love, T-I-M-E. He's at my games. He take me to practice. He makes sure I got what I need. He consistently in my corner. That's time. They seeing he love me. Now, daddy, help me tame this beast inside that's trying to this boy to man, this struggle. Help me tame this, bro. See, with being transparent. See, Willie, you and I, we wasn't raised where daddy just wanted to keep it transparent and real like that. Didn't have time dealing with the man on his back. Children such a, hey, boy, what I say? You such a, if you don't bring an A home, watch out, I'm going to beat the brakes off. They go for all y'all, and that's it. Next thing you know, mama bring your daddy, play the food in the bedroom. We ain't had no more talk with dad. Create an atmosphere where it is conducive for sons to have this dialogue, because here's the thing. You're a man, daddy, and there's a man inside of me, and then there's a boy inside of me, and they wrestling, they struggling. Help me with this, dad. Help me with this battle that's going on the inside. That makes sense, Willie?
It does, you know, and also on top of that, some of the things that people are dealing with, mentioning the trauma that's going from childhood into adulthood, they were touched on briefly, is that isolation. Because what happens is they begin to isolate themselves because they don't know who they can talk to. They don't know who they can trust.
Right.
And if you're consistently if you're hearing threatening remarks from people all around you, then that's going to cause you to go back into a deeper shell. You're going to begin to fear. And what fear does is fear brings about, again, the word isolation. And then if you fear or you're scared of somebody, you're not going to trust them because you don't know what they're going to do. You don't know how they're going to react. And you definitely don't know if you can tell them what's really on your mind. Because what's really on your mind is what can free you up if someone hears what you're saying. A lot of times, young men or young women also are crying out so hard. And even men now, grown folk are crying out because they want to be heard. And a lot of times they weren't heard. And because of the fact that they look at a person's age, they think they should be able to handle certain things. That's not the case. Don't look at the age. Hear the heart of the person that's crying out. They need help. And if you don't help them or somebody don't help them, then what happens is that as one of the listeners had mentioned about, because of the things that's going on in their life, they pick up a gun. They may pick up a gun or take drugs, any kind of thing to self-medicate or to take them out. And this is what they do because they feel that they are not being heard. And because of these things trickling over until the adulthood, they've had this all their life and they felt they had no one to listen to. So but now we got somebody to listen to you.
So Willie,
they're the counselors.
Let's go back to earlier this year in Chicago, the 14-year-old boy shoots the man.
Well, his mother was the cause of that.
Hold on, watch this. So that goes to show you that the choice that she made, because listening to the patrons and the people that were in there, they said, the mama said, shoot him. So once again, she's already arguing, and we see her texting the son to come in here, right? Instructing them, bring whatever. She wanted that smoke. That means this is the environment that you have been subjected to. You're in Chicago. Apparently, you're being subjected to that environment, and you have chosen to subject your son to that environment. And the notion of now, as if, so what we, and of course, we haven't, I'm pretty sure going into next year, we'll deal with it, seeing and following up on it. But here's the thing about it. As a woman, this wasn't your man. This was just a man you arguing with in the fast food line, that although he's making threats, you could have easily just took your stuff and walked out. Mm-hmm. You could have easily did whatever, but you got to the point where whatever traumatized you and whatever happened to you in your life, that you chose to actually involve your son, who unfortunately has to deal with the ramifications of everything that comes with him being live and the whole world see that he gunned a man down because he put his hands on my mama. Did it have to go like that? Do we actually think about the long-term ramifications of what transpires when we actually choose to go left versus going right?
Those decisions are never thought at the end. No one never looks at the future when they're in the present because of the fact that they feel they don't have time to think about it. I'm dealing with right now. I want satisfaction right now. That's why we got microwaves. We want something so fast and in a hurry, we don't have time to wait. But you go to a restaurant, what do? You sit there and you wait.
Right.
So, but here it is now. The consequences that people take is because of the way that they're feeling at that moment. Trauma happens at the moment. People feel threatened at the moment. And during those moments are most critical in the lives of the person that's getting ready to react. So what has to be done? Because it's, listen, when you don't take time to think, somebody's going to think for you later on. Talking about some of the ramifications. After all these events happen, you're sitting there in a jail cell by yourself or whatever situation it may be, if that's not the type of situation that you're in. You're depressed. You're lonely. You are going to have issues and trouble having a relationship because you're not going to be able to trust anyone. You're going to feel people are always out to get you, or what's that angle? What are they thinking about? How do they feel about me? What can I do? What should I do or not do? You have trouble having problems sleeping. You can't sleep anymore because why? You're wondering, okay, what's next? What do I do? How do I escape this feeling that I have? I can't get these thoughts out of my mind. And that's why, you know, earlier Don was talking about, and we've been talking about getting some help, counseling, getting therapy. Those things are essential if one wants to get over whatever trauma that they're dealing with. They may deal with it the rest of their life, but they will be able to cope with it once they have the type of help that they need to get to where they want, where they get to where they're trying to go. Just like this, if you go into another state, you take the train, bus, or car to get there. No matter what vehicle you take or what mode of transportation you take, the purpose is to get where you're going. So is therapy it? Then that's what you need to do. It's counseling it, then that's what you need to do. It's talking to a pastor, a lay person, a minister, that's what you need to do. If you have somebody you can trust, that's what you need to do. Get the help you need. There is nothing, there's no reason why we should be ashamed of some of the trauma that we've had in our life, especially because other people caused it. And then we're left having to deal with it.
So another thing we got to do in dealing with childhood trauma is, once again, men, women, mothers, fathers, grandparents, we have to avail ourselves to, once again, just being open to getting help. We have to avail ourselves. And here's the thing about it. Okay, trauma affects us in so many different ways, but there are so many different layers of trauma. You even have to look at just from like how trauma affects us physically. How it affects our health, how it affects us because the mind starts shutting down. You start seeing all this. And so many times, and I say that to say, because as men, notice the Bible says that husbands dwell with your wife with understanding, looking at them as the weaker vessel, dwell with them with understanding and knowledge. That means not just how women are wired and how women are created, but your wife specifically. What did she go through? Part of what helps to be able to deal with and help a marriage stay strong and work is, am I strong enough as a man to, if I say, for better or worse, if I say I love you unconditionally, am I strong enough to help you deal with the things that will come against you based on what's familiar in your bloodline? You see what I'm saying, Willie? Am I strong enough as a man? Now, no, you can't make nobody love you. You can't make nobody want to stay with you. But if a person sits back and both of us got stuff that we're going to go through seasons of our life, are we strong enough to help them through that crisis, through that trauma? Dwell with your wife with understanding, with knowledge. Do you understand what may have transpired in her life? What trauma? See, a lot of times we don't have this, and we go through these little makeshift counseling sessions to get married. We sit back and we really don't deal with this. And once again, next thing you know is people want to control the narrative when they actually never dealt with trauma. So how do we deal with it? Women control it through sex. Men control it through money. And so now we want to control the narrative because we're too afraid to deal with our trauma. We have, and so the kids are watching this. The kids are seeing this. And you got to know that God has a plan and there's help. But are you open to that help? And one thing that helps you deal with trauma, even if you go through as parents, counseling for communication, finding out how how he's wired, how she's wired, how he thinks and processes information, it allows you to understand. The next thing you know, when you say it this way, then, okay, like for instance, me and my wife, I talk to her all the time. I say, babe, well, I told you, you got to work on you can't take it. You're a literal learner. So if you sit back and it just reads this way, or they only heard this, like I literally heard this, but they missed all of this, it's because you're a literal learner. When I do my teachings online, Willie, I have a close friend who's a grammar queen, like professor, everything. But she breaks down to me, okay, you got to go back because we had like a debrief. You have literal learners. So when you read this or you said this, this is exactly how we take it. So now in the process of communicating, you're developing your communication skills. You have to recognize who the audience is. Just like when we talk and I sit back and I say, Willie, I'm coming from this way because I know there's a percentage of our audience that processes it like this. All of that is important in raising kids and dealing with trauma and recognizing how we're going to deal with the trauma because of how I'm wired, because of this and because of that and these things here. I have to know how he or she processes information. And a lot of times, unfortunately, we're raised in environments that we all at grandma every summer. It's 15 of us in their first cousins, and they say, what I say for one, go for all. But we got two cousins that don't think like that. We got two cousins. Them jokers don't, nah, they, you know. And that next thing you know, watch this. He was always in trouble. He was always doing this. He was all doing it because we do not take the time. And we become traumatized because we check out of life because nobody understand me. Nobody know me. They always treated me like this versus just sitting back to say, let's get some counseling for the communication purposes to stop to say, okay, he's wired a little differently. You listen to 106liveradio.com where excitement meets diversity 24/7. We are the male perspective. We'll be right back.
Broadcasting live from Atlanta while serving the entire globe. It's the fastest growing radio on the web. It's 106liveradio.com.
Don't let biased algorithms or degree screens or exclusive professional networks or stereotypes. Don't let anything keep you from discovering the half of the workforce who are stars. Workers skilled through alternative routes rather than a bachelor's degree. It's time to tear the paper ceiling and see the stars beyond it. Find out how you can make stars part of your talent strategy at tearthepaperceiling.org. Brought to you by Opportunity at Work and the Ad Council.
Streetwise, along with Focus Forward with Robin Shockley and 106 Live Radio, is in need of your help. Girls Gifted for God is requesting beauty products, toiletries, and non-perishable food items for their donation drive. For more information, visit streetwisegeorgia.org or contact Robin Shockley for drop-off and pickup details at 864-313-4964.
E. Miller, licensed professional counselor, has the formula for wholeness. Encourage, empower, educate, enrich. It's called the E Effect, and it will change your life. The E Effect will empower the individual who may be mentally impaired to get involved in programs to help them live a productive life. These programs will also enrich those in need by providing education and information which promotes a high quality of life. For more information, call Don E. Miller at 678-741-5337 or visit the website at Dotnet.
Are you ready to elevate your connections and improve your networking skills? Here, you can take your career, brand, and organization to the next dimension. Networking with Valerie is your passport for personal and professional growth. Tune in every second and fourth Saturday from 11 to 12 p.m. for our networking events. This is the place to build and maintain relationships on 106 R&B and Throwbacks, powered by 106liveradio.com. Yeah. Calling all authors. Do you want to promote your book? Get heard. Get seen. Make more money. Douglasville Books and 106 Live Radio is now offering promotional packages to create a better audience just for you. 770-949-4363. Douglasville Books, the people's choice.
Happy anniversary, 10 years, a wonderful station growing all over the world. Be a part, celebrate. Yeah.
We're excited.
Hello, I'm Don Eagle, host of The Male Perspective, live here on 106liveradio.com. Happy 10-year anniversary.
Yes, I'd like to say happy anniversary on 10 years to 106liveradio.com. Congratulations. May God continue to bless you with many more. We celebrate with you.
Congratulations.
We're in Atlanta, hitting the gas and turning all the way up
on 106liveradio.com. Today's R&B and throwbacks.
Broadcasting live from Atlanta while serving the entire globe. It's the fastest growing radio on the web. It's 106liveradio.com.
All right, we are back. Listening to 106liveradio.com, where excitement meets diversity. You've enjoyed the male perspective tonight, talking about the impact of childhood drama in adults.
Trauma.
What did I say?
You said childhood drama.
Childhood trauma, pardon me, the impact of childhood trauma in adults, because everything that happens in life follows us no matter how long we live. All right, Rhonda, I've enjoyed today's show and enjoyed having you to impart into us some information and knowledge. So how can you be reached, sir?
Yes, sir. I appreciate you that, Willie. It was a great show. Great show. Hope it was a blessing to the listeners. You can follow me on social media, Ron Robinson on social media, Rev Ron Speaks on IG, Instagram, and you can follow me on my YouTube channel, Your Pressing Moment Ministry.
Oh, that was quick.
Yeah, that was quick. Merry Christmas to everyone. Happy holidays. Listen, make sure you understand and know, be safe out there. As Don mentioned earlier, this is our last live show for the year. So it has been great, an honor, a privilege, a pleasure of being able to impart into you guys to be able to, you know, come with different topics to deal with subject matters. Thank you for all of the callers, all the listeners all year long. We love you guys. We're looking forward to a great 2024. You guys be safe. We're keeping you, your families in prayer, that God will bless you tremendously, keep you safe and cover you completely. Y'all take care. Be safe. Willie, it was great, my brother.
Yes, sir. We'll be right back. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back.
Are you ready?
The Godly Perspective is a segment within our show that highlights the truth of God's Word. Can you handle the truth, guys? Here is Willie LeGrand Jr. with God's perspective on the topic today.
All right, we are back. This has been an exciting show, The Impact of Childhood Trauma. I appreciate all of you all listening to us throughout this year. Has been said so many times tonight that this will be our last show, live show, but you are welcome. Please go back and look at some of these on YouTube. They're still impactful, they're still meaningful, and hopefully they will be a help to you. The Godly Perspective on our topic, I'm using Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10. For fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. Childhood trauma in adults. How does that apply? What actually is being said by Isaiah the writer at this particular time? Well, with understanding, it's telling us to don't be afraid. No matter what the situation that we face, no matter the trauma that we've dealt with, the things that has accelerated our heart that caused us fear, paralyzed us at times because we didn't know what to do when it happened. This verse is telling us that don't be afraid. The Lord God is with you. If you trust him, if you cast all your cares, everything that has happened to you in your life, give it to him. Let him know about it. Tell him how it makes you feel. Tell him the things that you've gone through. Yes, God is all knowing. He knows it anyway. But for you to tell him, it means something to you because you are exercising how you feel about him, that you are coming to him because you trust him. And believe this, he will not leave you. He loves you that much because, as I always say, that God so loved the world that he gave his only son, Jesus Christ, for the sins of the world, for everything that we would ever have to deal with. Jesus died for that, that we may be able to overcome. And in overcoming, we cast our cares upon him. We trust him. We allow ourselves to be free. He said he would strengthen us. How will he strengthen us? He will give us the ability to be able to go to the next level, to be able to come out of the feelings that we have, the emotions that we have, the pain and anger that we have dealt with. He will strengthen us to be able to handle it. Because how? Because we've given it over to him. He said he will uphold us with the right hand of his righteousness. We know that the right hand in anybody is usually the dominant side, the strong side. So if he's going to hold us up with his right hand of righteousness, then that says that we don't have to worry about anything. We know that he's there. He's holding us. He's covering and protecting us. It's okay to cry to him because he sees our tears. He knows how we feel. Cry out to him and let him love on you. When you allow him to love on you, there is no greater love than the love of the Father. The love of the Father God and his Son, Jesus Christ. They loved us so much that they don't want us to deal with anything alone. So just give it to him, everything that you're dealing with. Because why? Because he loves you. Because he's going to be there with you and he's going to help you through it. This is Willie. It's been great from the godly perspective. Have a great night.
Just like Sunday, white you fly on the side. Green light, everything is blowing my way. Clean, living dreams. Just like the barber and I'm feeling like this. Heard him say, give him praise. Sing the water, got you acting like this. Ain't a day going by, I don't try to thank the Lord up above. And if you wonder why I'm up in life, I'm posting like a USA. Ask me how I'm doing, I'm blessed. Yes, living every moment, no regrets. Smile up on my face, I'm like, yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed. Yes, ask me how I'm doing, I'm blessed. Yes, living every moment, no regrets. Smile on my face, I'm like, yes, I'm blessed, you know what I'm yes, blessed. I'm blessed, you know what I'm yes. Playing cards, laughing hard, barbecuing, waking up the whole block. Music loud, turning loud, little kids are breaking out the bus stop. Life is good, really good, and every moment, no, I can't forget. I gotta say, I won't change. You're the reason that I am like this. Ain't a day gone by that I don't try to thank the Lord up above. And if you wonder why I'm loving life, come close and I tell you what's up. Ask me how I'm doing, I'm blessed. Yes, living every moment, no regrets. Smile up on my face, I'm like,
Yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed. Yes, ask me how I'm doing. I'm blessed. Yes, giving every moment no regrets. Smile on my face, I'm like, oh, yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed. Yes, I'm blessed. 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 I'm blessed.
Thank God for another day. God, it ain't no need to find another way. I know trouble all around, try to tear us all down, but I gotta thank God every day above ground. Know the devil working day and night. But I look him in the eye, see you a damn lie. And I know I could have died at that time. I'm still around because I hear word never come back. And now I'm up on the door time, got a message for you. Might be stressing now, but that's the best I can point. And when it do through all the party and the nonsense, it takes some time to thank God for what he done. When you ponder you around, we come with the negative comments trying to get you to do something you better up all of them. Thank you.